Good morning and welcome to the service at Eau Claire Baptist Church. We're glad you came to see us here. We also are welcoming all those that are watching us online. We hope that you have a wonderful spiritual experience with us. Now, if you will take your hymnals and turn to 317, stand up and join me. We're going to sing verses 1 and 2.
Would you follow along as I read a call to worship today from Psalm 18, verses 1 through 3. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God, my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. Would you bow with me as we pray together? Our Father in heaven, we are grateful for this day of worship. Father, we are grateful to come into your presence, and we ask you, Lord, to just dwell among us as we gather together in your name. Father, you are worthy of our praise today. And as we bow before you in worship and in adoration, we confess to you, Lord, our shortcomings. We confess to you that we have fallen short this week in many, many ways. But we are grateful today that you are the God of our salvation. You are the God of second chances. You are the God of all hope and of all encouragement. And so, Lord, today we ask that you would be honored and glorified as we lift high the name of Jesus, the name above every other name, in whose name we pray. And all of God's people said together, amen. Well, you can be seated. And I'm so glad to see you this morning. I'm so happy to be back with you. And I'm excited about this day of worship we have together. In just a few minutes during our prayer time, I'll share some prayer needs with you from within the life of our church. I want to just share with you a couple of quick announcements so that you'll keep on your calendar. I want to let you know next Sunday we will have a church council meeting at 5 p.m. in the fellowship hall. So if you'll please make sure that's on your calendar. We just need to touch base about our continued plan for any fall events and ministries, and also just to align on where we are with our plan moving forward. Also want to let you know, 2 weeks from today, we want to have a prayer emphasis for our students and teachers, who many will be starting back to school this week. But 2 weeks from today, we want to have a special service of prayer and encouragement for our back-to-school folks. And then on September 12th, the Sunday after Labor Day, I want to let you know that is being set aside as a baptism Sunday that is being emphasized in the life of our denomination. And so So we want to support that, but we also want to use that as a back to church Sunday. And so I'll talk to you more about what that means over the coming weeks, but keep those couple of things in your mind. And I'm so happy to have Hunter share with us today from our group of lads that attended RA camp. And Richard, if you want to come and say a word, feel free. But it was a great experience last weekend. All of the lads that attended, both from Eau Claire and others as well, just had a really great experience. And I'm so grateful for ministries like that that are supported through our church. So Hunter, let me see if we've got another microphone for you to hold. All right, Hunter, and I'm so glad that you were able to go, and your dad was able to go, and we had a little bit of trouble on the way up, right? Flat tire, but God got us through that, so I'm so glad that you had this camp experience, and we're excited for you to share with us today.
So my name is Hunter, and I'm going to share about Camp McCall. M is for missions. We learned about missions around the world. C is for chapel. We went to chapel every night with Pastor Stephen. C is for campfire. We sang songs and met Chief Ugum Bugum. A is for activities. We got to pick activities to do, like the swing over the lake and fall of cobra, which is like dodgeball in the woods. L is for little waterfall. Was a hike to a small waterfall. We got to play in the water and get under the waterfall. L is for Lake Chili Water. The water was super cold and there was a zip line into the water that was really fun.
Amen. All right. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Hunter. I was going to say one other quick word. At McCall, it was kind of neat because there were two groups of campers that consisted of three generations. So a grandfather, a father, and a son/grandson. So that was really neat that we had a group there that represented three generations of campers at McCall. But I reinforce what Richard and Hunter shared, and great job to Hunter and Richard both. But it was an amazing experience. So thank you so much for allowing our church to be a part of that. And we will invite all of our children up front. I'm so glad to have Kelly back with us, and Malachi and your family after recovering. So thank God for that. But all of our children, if you'll come up front for a time of children's message with Kelly.
Hi guys, how are you? I think everybody's grown up during this crazy pandemic. You look like you are several inches taller, Mom and Dad. And Hunter, my goodness, what a good girl. Where are you? Where are you? Right there. Hunter, you did such a great job. That was super duper. You had fun? A lot of fun? Good, good. You look so sharp. I saw Mama taking her video of you, as proud as she could be. Well, tell me something. What happens this week? School starts back, Olivia. Yes, for everybody, is that right? School's starting back. Hey, Luke. Hey.
Yeah, I like my you. Shorts at school one time until a different day.
Oh, well, listen to that. We're really growing up during this pandemic. Did y'all hear that? A different day, Luke says. How old are you now, Luke? 4. My goodness, do you have a good time at Disney? That's, your mask has got Disney on it, doesn't it? So summer is ending and school is starting, right? I would wonder if any of you'd like to share with me a feeling word that you have about school starting back. Can you tell me one feeling you're having? I feel what about going back to school? And you don't have to tell me, but if you want to share, you can. Okay, Libby? Kind of sad, because why? Nothing like honesty, right? I know, summer's ending and sometimes school can be boring. Maybe you'll have a teacher this year that's just so dynamic and exciting and fun, you think? You do? Okay, well then maybe it's gonna be a good year, you know? We hope for that, we pray for that. Any other feelings that we're having about going back to school? Yeah, it.
My. Never crying about food. I'm hungry.
Okay, thank you. Well, I have this image in my mind that I want to share with you, and it's not just in my mind, it's actually in the Bible. And when I've been praying with Malachi and Cameron at night, I've been talking about God being like a big mama bird or a big hen that gathers her chicks under her wings. Did you know that the Bible talks about God that way? Let me read you this verse. It's in Psalm 91. And a lot of people have been talking about Psalm 91 during these coronavirus days where we've been saying, God, please protect our children. Please protect your world, God. Hide us under your wings. And listen to what the psalmist says. Do you know psalm is another word for song, like we just sang a little bit ago? And the church would sing these songs. And listen to this. God will cover you with feathers, and under God's wings you will find refuge. Do you know what refuge is? What does refuge mean? It means safety, comfort, protection. That just like that mama bird gathers her little babies under her wings, why is she doing that? She wants to what them? Protect them. That's right. And a mama hen gathers her chicks. Jesus said one time, oh, I long to gather you like a hen gathers her baby chicks. Look at these pictures. What do you see? Yeah? That mama duck protecting her baby under her wing. That's how God is with you and me. Look at this beautiful picture, and it even has the psalm under it. It says, God shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. Look at that. A swan with what? Her babies. Isn't it so cool that God wants us to know that God is like that too? What animal do you think that is? Another swan. You see, Luke? You see, Hunter? Malachi? And then look at this. Now, this is a kind of a cartoon picture, but not a real photograph. But what do you see here? A hen gathering her babies, her chicks. So I want you to imagine that our church is like that, that at school when you go, if you ever have a test that makes you scared or something happens with you and a friend and you just feel kind of alone, you can imagine that God's wings cover you. Why do we know that? Because we find it where? Right here in God's Word. Let's pray and ask God to help us remember that as we go back to school. Will you join me in praying? Dear God, thank you that no matter what we're going through, no matter how many things that might be on our mind as we go back to school, maybe we're going to miss summer, God, we can always know and we can always trust and believe that your wings cover us. I pray that these children will experience that as they go back to school, in life, in all kinds of ways, that when they're quiet and still and talking with you, they can imagine that your wings are stretched out over them, the feathery, soft, warm wings of our God. For that, God, we thank you. Amen. All right. Y'all have a good day. Okay, thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
But join me by getting your hymnals and turning to 450. We're going to sing I Need Thee Every Hour. Please stand. Verses 1 and 5.
Feel free to be seated. Thank you, Sandy, for leading us in worship today. Thank you, Joe, for leading us as well. If you have a Bible, our scripture reading again comes from Matthew chapter 5. We are close to the conclusion of our summer series on the Beatitudes, and so I pray that these have been a blessing to you as we've looked in depth at each Beatitude throughout the summer. On the way to church this morning, Ruby asked me what the sermon was about. And when I said the Beatitude, she said, again? And so maybe you feel that way again, but we're almost there. I pray these have been a blessing to you, as there's so much truth to God's Word through the beautiful Sermon on the Mount found in Matthew chapter 5. And I invite you to follow along as I read verses 1 through 12. I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible. And so, Matthew chapter 5, verse 1, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain. After he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Verse 9 is our focus for today. Blessed are the peacemakers, For they shall be called sons of God. And look what follows those who are peacemakers. Verse 10, blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And may God bless the reading of his word today. I want to share with you a few prayer needs from the life of our church. This morning, as we pray together, we want to continue praying for Miss Bobby Cato, who is in NHC Park Lane, and the no visitors policy has been extended for a few more days towards the end of August. So please lift Miss Bobby up to the Lord, and also continue praying for Mr. Lee during these days. I also ask that you pray for Michael and Tammy Finch. This is Miss Gwen's son and daughter-in-law. So they both were involved in a kidney transplant. And so the surgery went well for both. And so please pray for them as they recover. I know Miss Gwen will appreciate our prayers for them. I also ask you to lift Gene Moore to the Lord. He was diagnosed this week with acute leukemia and will possibly be going home on hospice. He's already home, so please lift up Gene and Lori and their family to the Lord. And then by way of praise today, we celebrate with Nikki Moore, who became engaged last Sunday to Christian. And so we rejoice with Nikki and Christian and their family, so I know they would appreciate your prayers as well. And we also rejoice for those in our congregation and through Koinonia that are recovering, have recovered from COVID. And so we thank God for that, especially over Kelly, your mom, Malachi. We praise God for recovery and for healing, and ask that you continue to pray for those that have been impacted by that. We also want to lift up those in the healthcare system, frontline staff who continue to treat and minister to patients who are dealing with coronavirus as cases increase. And then I ask you to remember our back to school folks who will be starting back this week or in the days to come. So a lot to pray about this morning. If you have an unspoken request, if you would just let it be known by the lifting of your hand so that I could see you. And I encourage you to know and remember that God knows already what we have need of before we even ask. And so we do serve a good God today who cares. And I encourage you to remember that he cares deeply for you. And so with that, would you bow with me as we pray together, please? Our Father, we again thank you for your presence this day. Lord, we call before you the names that we have spoken of this morning. Father, we lift up those that raised hands that have unspoken needs. Father, for those worshiping with us online today or watching the service at a later time, I pray for those watching that may have needs deep-seated in their heart and their lives. Father, we're so grateful that you are aware of what we have need of, even before we ask. And we thank you for being a compassionate God to us. And so, Lord, we bow together and we bring these needs before you that we've spoken of. Father, we pray especially for those that are dealing with the sickness of COVID. Father, we pray for those who have experienced loss due to this pandemic. We pray for those who are weary on the front lines, our healthcare professionals that are so faithful to help people. Lord, we lift them up and ask for an extra measure of your strength for those today. Father, we do stand in the need of prayer. And so, God, today we stand before you, Lord, and we're grateful as we focus on the Beatitudes again and those that are peacemakers. We're grateful that peace, first of all, begins with you. And, Lord, we're so grateful that we can have peace with God. We're so grateful that Jesus paid the price for our sin and makes it possible for us to be at peace with you, Lord. And so, Father, we ask your blessings today as we bow before you during this time of prayer and meditation. Would you speak to our hearts? We pray. Of God's people said together, amen. Well, the Bible speaks of peace over 400 times in Scripture. And so over 400 times there are direct references to peace. And in fact, if you look at the beginning of your Bible and the very end of your Bible, the Bible begins with peace in the Garden of Eden, and ironically, at the conclusion of the book of Revelation, the Bible ends with the peace that we will find in eternity. And so the Bible has a lot to say about peace. And we've read together Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, where Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." And so I want to speak with you today just about four areas of this peace that we read about in Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. And first deals with the meaning of peace. And so we would read verse 9, and it would be easy to just assume that Jesus is talking about here the type of peace that brings the absence of conflict and strife, which indeed we all want to see. But Jesus is talking about peace on a deeper level, and he's talking about the righteousness of God, which brings true peace. And in fact, how many of you can recite for me the Hebrew word for peace? Do you know what that is? Shalom. Say it a little bit louder. Say it with me. Shalom. And so the Hebrew meaning for peace, if you look at the root of what peace means to the history of the Hebrews, it expresses the desire that the one who is greeted will have all the righteousness and goodness that God gives. And so this peace we read about in verse 9, it is not just very simply the absence of conflict, but it is indeed all of the blessings that come with the righteousness and goodness of God. And so really the deepest meaning of the phrase for peace can mean God's highest good to you. God's highest good to you. We've got a reason to celebrate today because God's highest good is yours for the taking through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so God's peace is not just a surface peace that stops the hostilities, although we certainly long for that. I mean, none of us like to hear about wars or rumors of wars. I've been reading some of the news on Afghanistan throughout the day yesterday and hearing about some impact that has for a minority of Christians who are in that region. Surely we do want to see hostilities come to an end, and we do want to see wars cease. But God's peace not only does that on a surface level, but God's peace brings parties together in a sense of mutual love and harmony that is grounded in the righteousness of God. And so, verse 9, there is certainly a much deeper element here that is on the spiritual level. Scripture indicates this. Let me read a couple of verses. James chapter 3, verse 17 says, but the wisdom from above is first pure and then peaceable. And so there is that purity, that righteousness that comes first. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 says, pursue peace with all men and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord, or holiness without which no one will see the Lord. And so that spiritual element is certainly the foundation of verse 9. And so we understand that where there is to be God's peace, there is also to be righteousness and holiness and purity. And so when we read in verse 9 about being peacemakers, then we understand that to be true, genuine peacemakers on God's terms requires that peacemakers, that we be peacemakers on the terms of truth and righteousness. And you know as well as I do, because Jesus tells us in verse 10 and verse 11, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you. And so when we go beyond that surface level of peace and we go deeper to the righteousness of God that must be foundational for that peace, Jesus makes it very clear for us what's to follow. And we'll talk about this next week, but persecution is to follow. Being insulted is to follow. And so we know, because the world, as the Bible tells us, is at enmity with God when we talk about the righteousness of God that is required for us to stand before Him. When we talk about the forsaking of sin, such as verse 3, being poor in spirit. When we talk about mourning over sin, as we did back in verse 4, all of those things are elements of righteousness which result in this peace that Jesus speaks about in verse 9. And when we start to talk about that on a spiritual level, that's going to offend some folks and make some folks angry. And so the meaning of peace today, we understand, is there can be no peace apart from a right relationship with God. Look with me second today at the maker of peace. So verse 9, Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers. And so we must acknowledge together the great peacemaker, which is the Lord God himself. And we understand that those who are without peace, those that have no peace in their life, very likely have no God in their life, for without God, there is no peace. You really understand somebody who has the deep-seated peace of God in their life. You prayerfully are there, deep-seated in your heart and in your mind and in your soul. But this week I had a chance to visit with one of my heroes of the faith, Miss Mary Smith. When I was a teenager and came to Christ at the age of 14, in my home church, Miss Mary helped disciple me. She got me involved in a ministry of doing backyard Bible clubs in her community, and she would have me and other youth from our church come and lead those. She was just very instrumental in my life, in my commitment to following Christ as a teenager. And Miss Mary has always held firm to her faith, like many of you. And unfortunately, back in February of this year, Miss Mary took a fall in her home. She's in her early 80s, and very sad that she actually broke her neck in the fall. And so she has been bedridden since then. The family has now called in hospice, and they have asked me to come and visit her, pray with her. It's been a great joy to do that. And when I visited her this week, just knowing and hearing her say about the peace of God in her life, in the midst of no mobility, in the midst of pain and suffering physically, in the midst of a broken neck, to hear her talk about the peace of God that is in her life. Friends, this only comes when we know the God of peace. Amen? This only comes in our life in circumstances when we know this great peacemaker. And so, spiritually speaking, a couple of verses to help emphasize this. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14 talks about the great maker of peace. When Paul writes, "But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were formerly afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace." Colossians chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. "For it was the Father's good pleasure for all of the fullness of God to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross." And so we see a beautiful illustration of the Trinity in verse 9 that is underwritten here, because it is God the Father who is the source of this peace. And it is God the Son who manifested this peace for us, ironically, on the cross of Christ. And it is God the Holy Spirit that is the agent of that peace, that brings about this peace in our lives. And so the God of peace sent the Prince of Peace, who sends the Spirit of peace to give us the fruit of peace. And so we see the maker of peace is God. Notice, third today, this applies to you and to me, the messengers of peace, and that is we who are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. The messengers of peace are believers. In fact, God has given to you and me the privilege of being peacemakers. Now, this isn't just solving conflicts within our families. Let me ask for a show of hands. How many of you have conflicts within your family or extended family? We've all been there, right? We've got those conflicts that are surely to happen. And so it's not that we are sent to solve every conflict within our family. It's not that we're sent to resolve every argument or every disagreement, not so much on that scale, but we have been given the great privilege to be the messengers of God's peace, telling the world of the peace that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. In fact, the scripture emphasizes this in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 15. God has called us to peace. 2 Corinthians 5, 18. And now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, or the ministry of peace. Because really that's what peace is, right? It is celebrating that reconciliation between a lost soul, a lost life, reconciling that to being at peace with God. And so today we have been given the blessing, as we read about verse 9, we've been giving the blessing, we have been given this holy happiness of being peacemakers, of calling those that we know to be reconciled, to be at peace with God. What a great privilege you've been given today. What a great honor you've been given. If you ever wonder what purpose in life might be when life gets hard and depressing and discouraging, or when tough circumstances come, if we've ever wondered what our purpose on this earth is that we have been commissioned with the high and holy calling of being peacemakers in verse 9. Blessed or happy are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And look with me in closing today at the merit or the result of peace. What does it result for us to be peacemakers? What do we get out of the deal of verse 9? What's, as so many ask, what is in it for us? So many blessings of God follow verse 9, and the result of being a peacemaker is found in that second half of the verse in verse 9. For they shall be called sons, daughters, children of God. So today, the result of being an ambassador of God's peace, a result of being a messenger, a result of being an example of the peace that God desires to bring deep into the heart and life of every lost man, woman, lost boy, and girl, the result of being a peacemaker is that we will be called sons of God. Can I tell you today that God's children matter greatly to him? We heard it said during the children's message today, God cares deeply about his children. Don't mess with God's child now, amen? Don't mess with God's son or God's daughter. God cares deeply about his children. In fact, the Old Testament makes the parallel to the nation of Israel, saying that we as God's children are the apple of God's eye. I read one commentator that said that is essentially equating our place in God's view of being the depths of the cornea, which is the most protected part of the eye. It is the most protected part that our bodies and that our eyes are intended to protect for vision and for eyesight. And so the Bible equates us as God's children to being the apple of God's eye. That tells us that God is most sensitive about you. It tells us that God desires most to protect you as his child. You today as a peacemaker. You know, So often our minds and the enemy tells us what we are not, right? Have you been there? You're no good. You've heard that enemy attacking your mind and your spirit. You did terrible today. You did a terrible job. You're failing. The voice of the enemy so often tells us that. But verse 9 tells us today that you, as a peacemaker, that you are a son of God, that you are a treasured daughter of God, that you are highly favored, you are highly treasured as the apple of God's eye. And so in closing, I say to you that if we're going to be peacemakers, we must be, first of all, we must have made peace with God through Jesus Christ, His Son, and I trust that you've done that today. I trust that you have made peace with God through Jesus Christ, His Son. A peacemaker is one that leads others to make peace with God, and a peacemaker helps others make peace with others. And so today, I invite you to be a peacemaker. And I invite you today to recognize your highly treasured place in verse 9 as a son or daughter of God. Would you bow with me as we pray together? Father, we give you thanks again for these blessings that are ours through Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, today we thank you that as poor in spirit we can be blessed. As those who mourn over sin, we can be blessed. As those who are gentle or meek, we can be blessed. As those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, Lord, we can be blessed. As those who are merciful, as those who are pure in heart, Lord, we can be blessed. And today, Lord, as peacemakers, as your ambassadors, Lord, you have called and commissioned us to help others know what it means to be at peace with God. And Father, we bow today and we pray for those who are not at peace with you. Father, we pray today for those who are at enmity with you because of their sin. Father, we pray for those today that are separated from you, those who know no peace of God in their heart, no peace of God in their life, no peace of God in their mind. Father, we pray for those today who are at war within themselves because they are not in a right relationship with you. And oh, Father, today we rejoice because of the peace of God that is ours through Jesus Christ. Father, we rejoice today because for those of us who are your children, and I pray that is all of us, Lord, for those of us who have been reconciled through Jesus Christ, for those of us who have confessed and repented and been forgiven of our sins, Lord, what a blessing it is to live a life of peace as a peacemaker. Father, today we acknowledge that peace only begins with you. And I pray today that you would help us to have that deep-seated, deep-rooted peace of Christ in our lives. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And everybody said together, amen. Well, I invite you to stand with us as we sing verses 1 and 2 of hymn number 473, More Love to Thee, O Christ. Would you stand with us as we sing together?
Thank you.
With his benediction from the writings of Paul, and may the peace of the Lord guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. May we go in his peace today. God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. I love you so much, and have a great day in the Lord.